it is my honor and pleasure to introduce our next speaker, and that would be Eugenio Gino Jaramillo. Eugenio is the Director of Aviation and Construction for Amunila Construction Management, LLC, a heavy civil and general contracting firm headquartered in Miami, Florida, with offices in Fort Lauderdale, Dallas, and Panama. All right, he's also a former adjunct professor at Florida International University in Construction Management Department and at the Miami-Dade College in the Continuing Education Department. In 2017, after preparing, rehearsing, and delivering over 40 speeches, serving as president of the South Dade Club for 1 year, and Area 52 Director of another, in just 39 months, he earned the highest level of educational achievement in Toastmasters, International DTM, and Distinguished Toastmaster. Mr. Jaramillo is a public speaker. He has spoken at the Rotary Club of Miami, Florida, the International University at Florida Atlantic here, Toastmasters Club in Washington, D.C., Dallas, Texas, and Columbia, Bogota. There we go. I've got a time limit, so I'm trying to get past. Sorry, guys. With numerous Toastmaster clubs in South Florida as well. Mr. Jaramillo earned his BS in Electrical Engineering at the University of South Florida. He earned his Master's in Business Administration from the University of Miami. And he's certified member of the Southeast Chapter of American Association of Airport Executives. Let's please welcome Mr. Eugenio Jaramillo.
How fitting that we are gathered here today at an institution of higher learning. I'm here to talk to you about the top five things, in my opinion, that are not taught in schools. From elementary school, middle school, to high school, to this institution. How many of you have a degree from FIU? FAU? Two? So you're all aspiring degree students. Okay. Number one, public speaking, which is what I'm doing right now, which is what I did for 39 months with Toastmasters. How many of you are scared of public speaking? Terrified, mortified. I was too. How many of you have been on a debate team? And you think that that gave you public speaking experience? A little bit, but you need to practice. One class is not a public speaker major. It's like going to the gym. How are you gonna get big muscles? You have to go 3 to 5 times a week. The same thing with public speaking. I find that if I don't speak in public, I get rusty. So practice and stage time are critical to learning this skill. And it is a skill that you can learn. What you're seeing today is not, oh man, that guy's a natural. No, this guy has practice. I was a yoga instructor, I taught at FIU, I taught at Miami-Dade College, I was a trainer. Lots of practice will get you here. Jerry Seinfeld does a little skit that's pretty cute. He said that a study recently confirmed that speaking in front of an audience or a crowd is the number one fear, and we can confirm it today, right? Number two was death. How could that be? I thought it would be like spiders. So his conclusion is that if you were invited to a funeral, you'd rather be in the casket than give the eulogy. Now, some of you, as engineers, will work for a firm. You might work for a giant like Motorola, IBM, but you might venture out and be an entrepreneur. A single shop, you're a designer, you're an engineer, you're going to sell your design skills. You're an entrepreneur. Can I get a volunteer to lead? That says, right here, you're welcome to stand up.
Okay.
And breathe nice and loud.
Okay. You can't outsource public speaking as an entrepreneur. It's up to you to be the face of your business. Said by Allison Shapiro, founder and CEO.
Everybody know Warren Buffett? Yes?
Yes.
One of the top three billionaires in the United States. Been for a while, along with Bill Gates. You know who's number three or number one now? Jeff Bezos from South Florida, Amazon. He says that mastering the art of public speaking is the single greatest skill to boost your career. And this is the place where you can do it. Toastmasters. It's the largest and oldest organization you've probably never heard of. How many have heard of Toastmasters?
More than the average bear.
It was founded 93 years ago by Ralph Smedley at the YMCA. There's more than 352,000 members worldwide. We're in 141 countries. There's over 15,900 clubs and more than 2,000 in the U.S. alone. And guess what? There's one right here at FAU. What a resource. Go to it. It's weekly every Thursday from 5:15 to 6:25. 1 hour chop chop, meaning start on time, they end on time, no lollygagging. FAU House Chamber Student Union. Who's up for it? And you know what? It's cheap. It's like $6 to $10 a month. Try signing up for a Dale Carnegie course. A couple $1,000s. And you're not going to learn anything from the course. Why? Because you have to practice. And this will give you the practice. Here's some of the top benefits of Toastmasters, in my opinion. Public speaking will help you remove the fear. You'll get up in front of an audience of maybe 20, some of them are your peers. You'll be in a comfortable environment, so you can get out of your box and start to remove that fear. Communication. You learn some communication skills. Remember, it's not what you said, but what the other person thinks you said. And I have a story. I got a call from the president of the company, my friend. I've known him for 40 years. He's kind of an excitable guy, and he's working on a proposal for Terminal B, Port Miami, design, build, port expansion. He's all excited. Gino. Gates, what do we do with Gates? Gates, what are you talking about, George? Well, Gates, and the airport. Which airport, George? We worked at Miami International and Fort Lauderdale. Well, you know, Gates, both Gates. You know, that thing that goes up and, oh, George, you mean the passenger boarding bridges. And that's what he's talking about. So he didn't communicate it to me. I had to draw it out. Communication, you're gonna learn that great skill. The one I just told you was listening. We have people check on your grammar. We have people check your ers and your ahs and your ums. We have people time you. So that's listening. You have to listen. You have to listen with your ears and with your eyes. You have to learn the first two or three skills to be a leader. You are going to learn leadership skills. And that's the name of this conference, isn't it? Leadership-y? Impromptu speaking. James referred to it. When you go to an interview, what is that? That's impromptu speaking. You have no idea what they're going to ask you. You need to be able to think on your feet quickly and eloquently give a good answer. Cool thing that happens at Toastmasters is that when you give a speech, a prepared speech, there's a manual, has 10 prepared speeches. There's a section in the back where you are going to get a written and a verbal evaluation of your speech. What does that do? It's feedback so that you improve. You're going to get better at this. Another sidelight of this is that you learn great stuff, content. I had a gal give a speech the other day on minimalism. It's awesome. You can learn how to make lemonade. I don't know. You're going to learn something else other than these public speaking skills. James brought it up. Networking. What I like to say is, if you're not networking, you are not working. And networking is not about being like a sniper. You go out there and you shoot, and you get you go home with a pocket full of cards. No, it's more like farming. Where you go and you get that one special card and you spend some time with that person. Get to know them. Build a relationship. That's what networking is all about. You'll be able to do that at Toastmasters. Here at FAU, it's a rather homogeneous club because it's all students. But if you go to other clubs, and I do encourage that, because in order to make a commitment to this, you need to find a place that's convenient for you in both location and time, and that you like the club. Otherwise, what happens? Oh, that meeting is on Wednesdays at 7:30, and it's about 20 minutes away. You know what, it's kind of rainy and kind of cold. I'm gonna stay in bed with the snooze button. But if it's convenient to the time, the location, and you like the people of the club, you will show up. If you go to a Toastmasters meeting once a week for the whole year, you will have 52 hours of public speaking training for $6 a month. Can't beat that, right? The next thing is leadership. And I have the word others there, because leadership is not about you. It's about others. It's about serving others, mentoring others, influencing the lives of others, giving credit to others, and being a role model to others. If you can't serve, if serving is below you, then leadership is beyond you. How many of you think you're a good manager? How many of you think you're a good leader? Okay, being a good leader is much more important than being a good manager. Managers manage things. Leaders lead people, influence people. The late, great Steve Jobs said this. And what did he say? Stand up and go ahead and read it. Tell us your name and what it says. Jobs. I followed his life, his whole career, because he's a contemporary of mine. Sad that he died so young. But Steve used to, people said about him that he altered reality. You heard that phrase about him? That's pretty amazing. I work with five brothers, and one of the brothers alters reality all the time. How many of you heard of John Maxwell? Author, written many, many books, sold millions of copies, been on the New York bestseller list many times. He's got two books here that I recommend, The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership and The 21 Indispensable Qualities of a Leader. He's also a pastor, he's an author, he's a speaker. And he says this. What does he say? Go ahead and stand up and read it.
Caesar. Leadership is not about titles, positions, or flowcharts, it is about one life and control.
Thank you. Now, without getting too technical on this slide, if we start at the bottom, here's what's going to happen to you in your career. You're an engineer for a firm. You're a good engineer for that firm. You do it 3, 4, 5 years, and then your boss comes to you and he says, we want you to be the manager. You're the manager of this set of engineers over here because you're a good engineer. Ooh, manager or leadership. That first position is position. It's because of your position. People follow you because they have to. You're the boss. They have to listen to you. Then you go to the next level, which is all about relationships. So now people will follow you because they want to. They see you as a leader, not as the boss. Level three is now production. You've got some results for the company, some results for people. So it's because of what you have done for the organization. They're going to say, oh yeah, that guy, he worked in business development. He brought in $250 million worth of work for the company. That's a guy I want to follow. The fourth one is people development. People follow you because of what you have done for them. Remember, my first slide was all about others. What you do for people, they will remember. And the pinnacle is a level five leader. And that's what we should all aspire to be. That is where people will follow you because of who you are and what you represent. You say, oh, I want to follow that guy. He's pretty cool. He travels, he speaks, he's an engineer, he's a found object artist, he's a yoga teacher, he's a professor at FIU and Miami-Dade College. He leads a pretty cool life. I think I'm going to try that. Here's the difference between a boss and a leader. How many of you had this guy, the boss, where he creates fear? You don't do this, you're going to get fired. But the leader builds confidence. The boss is always looking for who to blame. I had a guy that said, if anything goes wrong, it's your fault. But if it goes right, I get all the credit. That's the kind of boss you don't want to have. So a leader corrects his own mistakes or corrects your mistakes in a gentle manner. A boss knows it all. You can't tell him anything. He's formed an opinion before you even went there with a suggestion or a solution to a problem, right? Seen those? A leader asks questions. I have guys that have worked for me that are engineers, and they're very good at what they do. Estimator. I had an estimator. He was like my idiot savant. He could drop a box of toothpicks, and he'd know how many toothpicks were there. But he couldn't tell me how he counted. So when he came to tell me something, I had to interview him. He goes, slow down, J-Rob. Hold on. Let me ask you the question. Because he's like a walking encyclopedia. Oh, that was RFI number 242, purchase order number 55, change order number 20. Wait a minute. I need to know all that stuff. And I would have to interview him. So good leaders ask questions. The third thing I think they don't teach you about is personal finance. How to deal with your money. The idea of making money and why you are getting this higher education degree is to make more money. But it's not how much you make, it's how much you keep. It's not how much you spend either. So you have to be able to work and stay on a budget. Did you guys have any classes on staying on a budget, balancing your checkbook? If you all have checkbooks. Millennials, you have Venmo and PayPal and all these other things. You got to know how much money you have so you know how to spend it. And as far as building up, I'm kind of young for this, but retirement. Retirement will come one day. They always talk about the three-legged stool. Social Security. There's personal savings, which you should try to do. And then there's the retirement, right? Known as the 401k. In higher education, it's 401b. There's many plans. These are all employer-sponsored plans. Now, what I did with mine is I started as early as I could. I encourage you to start early. Save on your taxes. It's not going to take that big bite out of your pocket. You are going to pay yourself first. And what I did is I put the maximum in there that my employer would match. Say you save $4,000 a year in 401k. He puts another $4,000. You just doubled your money. That's a no-brainer. Please enroll in the company's 401k as soon as you can. One of the things that allowed me to do, I was young, I was able to buy my first house. Borrowed money, my own money from my 401k. I did gave the down payment for my home and I have a home. Now, the other cool thing I did is that age 59 and a half, magical age, I am able to retire my funds, retrieve my funds from the employer-sponsored 401k, put it into a self-directed IRA, which allowed me to save fees, which allows my nest egg to grow more, and I went and traveled the world for 10 months.
Nice.
I said, I'm taking a page out of the millennials book, and I'm gonna go travel for 10 months. I have young kids who are in Spain, or in France, or in Canada, or in Colombia, or in Siesta Key, and I had a great time. But then they came back and said, man, we need you. We've got this huge airport job, and we have no idea what we're doing. So please come back. And I did, and people asked me, why did you come back? Well, I made them an offer that I couldn't refuse. 401k, get with it. Now there's other multiple income streams and you should try to develop them if you can. Residual income, anybody have an example of that?
Blogging.
Pardon?
Blogging.
Blogging, if you get paid for it, yes. How about Carrie Underwood? She sings a song, records the song, and those CD sales are coming whether she's sleeping or it's like a continuous income, that's residual. Passive income is where you're not actively doing anything, maybe you're an investor in a firm, I happen to own part of a registered investment advisory, and I have some income from there. There's business income if you start your own business, there's a lot of advantages because as an employee, what happens? You are taxed first on all your income, and then you have everything left over for your expenses. As a business, you have all your expenses, and then you're taxed. So some huge tax advantages. And then whole life insurance, I know it's a little soon for you guys to think about it, but it's a great leg to have. It helps you in retirement, it helps with your kids' education, and you can borrow against them. Proper exercise. Not taught in school. So you have to find what works for you. In your youth, you're probably into team sports, which is a good thing. You have a support community that says, hey, let's go play football, soccer, racquetball, whatever. But as you get older, like me, you have to find less rigorous things to do, but you have to do something. You have to do something at least three times a week. How many of you are like these weekend sport jockeys? Where you go and you play your heart out, and then Monday you're hurting like the Dickens. You have to work out at least three times. Because if you work out less, that taxes your heart. Three times works out the heart, strengthens the heart. You have to make a commitment to do this. How did I make a commitment? I became a yoga instructor. I knew that I had to show up there, that I had to be in front of that mat. It didn't matter if I was sick, if I was sleepy, if my stomach was bloated. I had to show up and teach those 40 students. They were counting. So you have to be disciplined. When the embryo is first forming in the womb, the heart forms first, and the second thing that forms are the arms. Start coming out. So you have to do something that makes you move your arms, makes you have aerobic exercise. So find what works for you and do it and stick to it because your health is your wealth. The last thing is proper nutrition. It's not what you eat, it's what you should not eat. It's about making the right choices and not skipping meals. So what happens? Say you skip breakfast. Here comes lunch. What are you going to do? You're going to eat the first thing you see. You'll eat a napkin. You'll eat a pizza box. You're so hungry, you're going to make a really poor decision. So eat those three meals and eat the right things. A lot of people talk about, oh, read packages. Read the labels. If you're reading a label, there's something wrong with that product already. Because if I go to the produce section of Publix and I look at a bag of apples, that doesn't have a list of ingredients. Apples are good for you. So stay in that produce section of Publix. That's a good spot to be. Don't go in those center aisles, or you're gonna read all those packages. Not good. Eat as raw and as green as you can. I do a green juice every morning. That's what worked for me. Here's my last quote. If a diet is wrong, medicine is of no use. If a diet is correct, medicine is of no need. So let food be thy medicine. The purpose of my speech today, as in Toastmasters you'll find out, was to inform you, to persuade you to take care of your career, because the company you work for owns your job, but you own your career. So work on your career. It's up to you to get the training and the certifications that you wish to pursue. I hope I entertained you, and I hope I inspired you to do better. Thank you. Open it up to any questions. Yes, sir. The typical meeting is 1 hour, starts on time, ends on time. We have three parts. One is prepared speeches. The second part is impromptu speaking. And the third part is evaluations. And there are functionaries that help. For instance, I mentioned the RA counter, the grammarian, the timer, the vote counter. 1 hour, in and out. Anybody else?
Yes. I have a question. So I'm really into yoga too.
Oh, yeah.
I'm studying bioengineering in the MBA, and I kind of want to get an aerial yoga teacher certification.
Yes.
Would that be helpful, or is that kind of like getting off the path?
No, I think it serves two things. The bioelectrical, maybe you come up with some crazy new invention, and it's certainly serving your health. So get that certification. Thank you. Anybody else?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
If you could tell your younger self one thing, what would you do?
The one thing I would tell my younger self is that to the path of life, everything's going to be okay. It's okay to study engineering, work for a computer manufacturer, and then never work in the engineering field again. I became a real estate developer. I sold knives. I flipped burgers. And then I got into the construction business. So everything's going to be okay. It's a path. Just keep going. Keep moving. Keep showing up to work. Everything's going to be okay. Yes, ma'am.
So, why did you get out of Toastmasters and you didn't get out of teaching yoga? Because for both, you have to stand in front of an audience. You have to lead, et cetera, et cetera. So what did you get from Toastmasters and you didn't get?
Fantastic question. Thank you very much.
I asked you because I'm a Zoom instructor. So every day of my life, I stand in front of an audience.
Nice. Applaud you. I came to this realization only recently. I delivered 40 speeches, more than 40 speaches. I was a president, dairy director, which is leadership and speaking. Now that I have this little pen, it's called Distinguished Toastmaster, I changed the acronym to mean devoted to mentoring. And so lately, I've been mentoring people. In fact, I became so good at evaluations that I won the club contest, and I won the area contest, and now I'm competing in the division contest on evaluation. And as soon as I started giving evaluations and focusing on others, like I said earlier, my life is like blossoming. I now have my first paid public speaking gig, speaking to 60 plus professionals from United Airlines in Chicago about construction aviation business.